Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. It's Halloween night, so turn out your lights and make sure your pumpkin is lit. Are you ready? I had a frightening experience when I was a child. Back in the 1970s, there was a place called the Moonbow Cottages near Cumberland Falls in Kentucky. I was just a child back then, and I've tried since to find it on maps today so I could tell you where it's at, but I can't find it now. There was a lake there, and cabins, and there was a long building that had motel rooms along with the office where you checked in at. The cabins and the lake were set down in a basin area that you had to drive down from the main road to get to. Everything there was surrounded by woods that were thick and dark. Our family went there a couple years in a row because we had family living in the area. But the last time we were there, I believe it was 1978, we were in one of the back cabins. My parents slept in one bedroom, and I was alone in the other. Each room had a window on both sides of the outside walls, so one window faced out the side of the cabin, and the other looked out over the gully and into the trees that started behind the cabin. I don't recall if there was air conditioning in the bedrooms, but I don't believe so because I recall we slept with the windows open. One night, I woke up and I had to use the bathroom. We left the bathroom light between the two bedrooms on since it was an unfamiliar place. That night, out of habit, as I was leaving the bathroom, I switched the light off. I did this with my right hand as I was walking out of the bathroom into the hallway. I did this because I always got yelled at home if I left a light on anywhere. But as soon as I did that, I knew I should have left the light on. As I stood there in the doorway of the hall, I could see straight through to the window next to the bed that I had been sleeping in. There in the dark, I could see the outline of a shape at my window. It was outlined from the outside light from the next door cabin, and that was the side that sloped down and went back towards the end of the cabin. It was pretty steep there, so how could someone be standing there? I turned and ran into my parents' room and woke them up. I told my dad there was someone outside. There was a group of young people renting a cabin by us. They were renting for the whole summer. They were running some kind of whitewater tour group on the fly or something like that. My dad immediately thought that I must have seen one of them. Not at my window, but he thought I was mistaken and had seen one of them outside their cabin, and maybe it looked like they were closer to my window than they really were. My dad told me to go get back in bed, but I refused. I had seen news about some little Girl Scouts being murdered. I was not going back to that bed alone. After a while, they finally let me sleep with them. You know, it's funny how the mind of a child works, because I forgot all about the shape at the window until the next night, and then I only briefly thought about it as they tucked me into bed. I had spent a full day playing outside. I was worn out, and I fell quickly asleep. I woke up to a strange sound. I sat up and listened in the darkness. There was a rubbing sound. It was the sound of something rubbing itself against the corner of the cabin. There were little grunts and huffing sounds and scrapes. I remember I sat there almost giggling in bed because I had this crazy picture of Yogi Bear out there scratching his big backside on the corner of our cabin. Strangely, I had no thought of the shape that had been at the window the night before. I got up, with no fear, and looked out the side window. It was dark out there, but the cabin next to us still had their light on outside. The cabins weren't very close together, but they were situated in a semicircle, so the light from the front of one cabin would light up the next cabin's back and the side, if you can picture that. There was something I could see out there, all right. At first I thought it must be a bear standing up, rubbing its butt on the cabin. and then it straightened up and stepped away from the cabin. And I no longer believed that was a bear. I thought it was a man, and he had come in the night to kill us all. And it was a really, really big man, much bigger than my dad. I ran down the small hall to my parents, yelling, "Mom! Dad!" They were none too pleased to be awakened for a second night in the row. Concerned, though, my dad did get dressed, but he was still thinking that it might be one of the Whitewater people next door to us. So he went and had a talk with them, because he could see they were still up. He came back, convinced that it wasn't any of them, and they had all agreed it was probably a bear. One thought they had seen one out in the trees previously. So the very next day, they all together reported to whoever that there was a bear there. Some people did come out, very official looking, and they looked around. I don't know who they were or where they were from. My dad made me stay in the cabin. But from what I could see inside, they were just men in uniforms to me. They could have been park people. Could have been the local police. I don't know. They all spent a lot of time looking around my end of the cabin, and down the gully, and up the slope to the trees, and behind the other cabins in the area. After they left, my father told me they decided it was a bear, and a really big one from what they saw. Everyone in the area was advised to be very cautious for a while. A bear coming up that close was a very bad thing. I was now restricted and was no longer allowed to roam in the area, which I had been accustomed to doing. There was no cable there, and I think you only got 3, maybe 4 channels on the television, which was very fuzzy and hard to watch. But now I had to stay within sight of the cabin. Very close. Very boring. We had had room in our Chevy van to bring some of my Barbie stuff along on the trip, which was a good idea, because even though we were visiting family, they were all older, and there were no younger children. I also had room to play with the Barbies on the long drive there, so it was perfect. I brought my favorite thing, my new Barbie RV, with me. I had just gotten it the prior Christmas, and I loved that thing. I was playing with that, outside in the grass between the 2 cabins, between ours and the Whitewater people. That's when I first saw what it was that had been scratching on my corner of the cabin. A pebble landed near where I was playing. I looked up and around, but I didn't see anyone, so I guess I shrugged and went on to playing with my Barbies. Then another pebble came. I had turned, and I had seen where it had came from out of the corner of my eye. I turned and looked in that direction, and I stopped when I saw something brown. The land fell away at the back of the cabin, forming a deep gully. Then it went back up on a slope, and the trees started up the top of the slope. I would think the gully was about 10 or 12 feet at the bottom. The brown thing I saw, it was at the base of where the trees started on the other side of the top of the gully. I was scared because I thought by the shape, it was definitely a bear. You see, we lived in Rockford, Illinois. No one had ever coached me on what I should do if I saw a bear, because obviously there are no bears in Rockford, Illinois. So I did nothing. I stayed squatted down by my Barbie RV. My head was down, but my eyes were raised, watching it. Then a few more pebbles came flying at me, and out of nowhere one hit me sharply on the leg. It stung. I stood up quickly. To my amazement, so did the brown shape. And that's when I knew it was not a bear. Even little child that I was, I knew something was wrong here. I saw regular arms with hands. The brown shape took a few steps forward down the slope of the gully, like it was coming straight for me. It was clearly out of the trees now. Then it suddenly made itself very small on the side of the slope about halfway down. It quickly sat down and wrapped its long arms around its knees and tucked its head in close to the body. I had to blink twice to be sure of what I was seeing, because If I hadn't seen it move, I would have believed that I was just looking at a tree stump. Now, I was scared before this, but now I was out of this world scared. That thing was staring at me. Being a kid, maybe I wasn't the sharpest crayon in the box out there, but I somehow knew it was trying to get to me. I didn't know how or why I knew it, but it wanted me. Then I saw why it had suddenly gone down and played tree stump possum, as I had begun to think of it. One of the guys from the Whitewater group in the cabin next door came out, and he either put something in or got something out of the car that was parked on the gravel in front of the cabin. Walking back, he says, "Hey, Sherry, looks like you're having a little fun there." Now, all the Whitewater people were very nice to me, and all of them went out of their way to talk with me or play with me. Normally, the family that owned the place had a daughter who was there to play with, but she was not there that year for some reason during that week. I remember her name was Kelly. But anyway, they were kind to me, and they knew I didn't have anyone to play with, so they always took time out to talk to me or play with me. I wish I could remember all their names, but I don't. I couldn't look away from the tree stump over on the slope. "No, I'm not," I said. "I'm not having fun. I'm scared." I remember saying it in a very small voice. I was afraid of saying it too loud. I heard gravel crunch, and then I heard the grass as he walked over to me. He squatted down next to me. Even though I was standing, he was only a tad shorter than me when he squatted down. He was a pretty big guy, and I was a pretty small girl. I guess it evened us out. "What did you say?" he asked me. "Did you say you're scared? Why are you scared?" It took me a half of a second or more before I could make my voice work. "There's something on the slope," I said. "See it?" I saw him turn his head and look down between the two cabins. A second or two went by, and he didn't move, and he hadn't said anything. "Do you see it?" I asked him again. Another second passed, and then in a very low and slow voice he said to me, "Sherry, I want you to slowly walk to your cabin, okay? Slow. Walk slow. I'll wait right here until you get inside, okay? You can leave all your stuff." I didn't really have to be told twice, but there was a second delay before I could make myself move. I finally moved when I felt him nudge me on my arm. As soon as I started walking toward the cabin, that tree stump stood up, and it sprinted back up the slope incredibly fast, and it was lost in the trees. You could hear the branches moving and things breaking as it ran away. "Did you see it? What was it?" I yelled out to him. But he was already running to where I was. He scooped me up like I was a football and bolted straight into our cabin. My mom was in the little kitchenette area, packing up food that she had made to take to the barbecue that we were going to that afternoon at my great-aunt's house. Of course, Mom was startled and taken aback at somebody bursting into the cabin. "What is it? What's happened?" my mom said, walking towards us quickly. I hadn't even seen my dad sitting over there in the living area. I think he was reading a newspaper. But at the sight of us, he flew out of that chair and met us with Mom. Both of my parents were just convinced I had been badly hurt. But I wasn't crying or anything like that. The Whitewater guy sat me down over on the couch. Then he talked to my parents over in the kitchen area. This was not some big cabin, and there were no walls between living and kitchenette, but I still don't know what they said. I probably heard it at the time. I'm sure I did. But I think I must have been in shock, or maybe I've just chosen to forget it. And I also don't have any clear memories of what it was exactly that happened next. I know that suddenly some uniformed people were back out there by the cabins. I don't know if they were the same ones that came before. I do know the family that owned the place. They lived on site. They were genuinely concerned. As I said, they also had a young daughter who was usually there. But Even without her there, they were very concerned. They called someone else that they knew with hunting dogs. Everything over there was combed behind all the cabins and all around the whole grounds. And what was found or decided, if anything, was not relayed to little old me. You see, we were leaving in 2 days anyway, and the remaining days there were already planned to be spending with family in the region during the days, and we were getting home late, going in, and, incredibly, my parents told me to sleep with them in their bed. We did go home to Rockford, Illinois, and, to my knowledge, it was never mentioned again, at least not to me. As I've mentioned before, the mind of a child works in strange ways. I must have locked that memory up, you know, in a small box somewhere, with all the discarded toys and all the books that I had outgrown. And it stayed there in that little box until more recent years, when something I heard on the news made me think about it again. Now, we did go down and we visited family down there again, but we stayed at the big state lodge there by the falls. Never again was what had come down from the trees talked about in front of me again. Now, this might not be scary to you as you listen to it, but it was one of those childhood memories that, if you think on it, suddenly you're electrified. Something fires up in your brain, and you instinctively know there was more to that than you remember, more to that than you were told, more to that than you will ever know. And somehow, you just slid by some big, fateful moment. It was momentous and important, but no one ever told me the details, and now there is no one to ask. I think back on all the adult reactions around me at the time, and I see their concern was real. No one, though, took the time to tell me that it was just a big old bear on the slope behind the cabin. And I now find that really odd. If they thought it was a bear, the second time, the tree stump, that is, wouldn't they have just told me so? They did, just the day before. As I said, a child's mind is so strange, and yet it's so incredible. Thank you for letting me share this with you. Halloween of 2001 was a rare and wonderful Halloween night with a full moon. You don't get too many of those in a lifetime. So I remember that Halloween well, and not just because of the full moon, but because of what that full moon lit up for me and my friends that night. We lived in Newport, Virginia, and my best friend Mike, he was lucky that his parents had bought a very large piece of land some years before. Their plan was to hold on to it and build a house when they retired. But in the meantime, that land was used heavily by all the family and a lot of friends for hunting and for one-night bonfires and campouts. This piece of land was off Bluegrass Trail. There was a rough-cut driveway from the road that went back a couple hundred feet to a parking area. And if you didn't know where that driveway was, you would have driven past it 1,000 times and never seen it. Now, from that parking area, you were on foot all the way to the clearing several yards from there. The clearing had a fire pit and a small shed-like building that was far too small to sleep in. It might have been 3 foot by 4 foot. There was also a stack of lumber that was covered by a tarp with some bricks. Mike and his brother and his dad had carried all of that lumber piece by piece from the parking area that summer before. The plan, again, was to build a small cabin before winter, but like many things, it just didn't happen. So otherwise, once we parked, we were on foot once we left the parking area, and once we got to the clearing, there was no shelter for us. So, our plan that Halloween night was a pretty simple one for some young men. Our plan was to be young man stupid and to do young man stupid things. That's what my dad called it. The plan was to sit around the fire, have some drinks, pull pranks on each other, tell stories, and just be stupid. You know, we might have been young men in our 20s, but on Halloween, we were still that same group of boys you'd have found 15 years ago, running around, wearing plastic fangs, swirling our dollar store Dracula capes at each other, and carrying pails and pillowcases, running as fast as we could to collect all the trick-or-treat loot. Yeah, we wanted to be kids again. Now, we had been out there before, so as for myself, I was comfortable with the area. We got out there and met up around 10 p.m. We made a couple trips, carrying our beer and coolers and chairs and snacks. We used flashlights between the parking area and the clearing where we were setting up. And the moonlight made it so much easier. The moonlight was incredible. It was like we had some big auditorium lights out there at times. Everything was a misty blue-white, all lit up with a lot of shadows cast deep into the trees all around. Talk about a perfect setting for a Halloween night. We had been there for a couple of hours, drinking, cutting up, and having fun. We also had brought some tents to sleep in, and I was sharing my tent with Mike, and the other three guys were sharing a bigger tent together. Now, I was the smarter of the group. As soon as we got there, I put my tent up before I cracked my first beer. The other guys, well, they cracked beers first. They still had theirs to put up at almost midnight. And that's a lot harder once you've got a few beers in you. Me and Mike had to laugh watching the three doofuses, half drunk, trying to put their tent together. Eventually, they just gave up and said, forget it, they'll sleep in their bags. Me and Mike were like, okay, but if you get scared, don't think you're coming in our tent and laying all over us. We were loudly and repeatedly assured by them. They weren't scared of anything. At some point, I called it quits, and I crawled into our tent, very aware that the rule was the first person in the group to fall asleep was highly at risk of being pranked in a very juvenile manner. Think shaved eyebrows or shaving cream in your hand. But I just couldn't stay awake anymore, and I was counting on them out there being so bombed out of their minds, they wouldn't be able to get a prank plan together. I also made a point of not announcing that I was going to go to sleep. I walked out into the tree line, under the guise of doing some personal business. I did that, zipped up, and circled back around through the trees, sidled up to the side of the tent, and slipped in, I believe, without them noticing. I drifted off, feeling like I was spinning on some carnival ride. I could hear the guys out there being loud and cutting up as I drifted to sleep. Now, sometime after that, I was vaguely aware in my drunken sleepiness that my friend Mike had come into the tent and he got into his sleeping bag. I remember with one eye half open, I looked out and I could see the light of the fire outside. It had gone very low, almost out. I heard my friends that I'll call Jim, Bob, and Pete. They were out there, trying to settle into their bags under the moon and stars. Now, during our evening sitting around, we had heard what sounded like owls, but we all agreed they sounded off. Maybe they were a strange owl that just passed through the area. We didn't know, and we didn't give it a lot of thought. You live out there in the sticks, and you start absorbing all the things you hear, and you don't give them too much thought. And owls were something you heard rather frequently. After Mike came in, I was drifting back off, and I heard the odd owl call again. But this time, it was really close to the tent. I opened a bleary eye, and now I noticed that the fire outside was higher than it had been when I last saw it. Maybe one of the guys had gotten back up? Had the breeze maybe rekindled the glowing embers and started a new fire on its own? I've seen it do that before. Then I realized somebody was walking around out there. But even half drunk asleep, I knew something wasn't right with what I was seeing. I was seeing a huge shadow on my tent of something standing upright. But wait a minute, I thought. The shadow projection to make one of the guys I knew seem that big against my tent? There would need to be a lot more space between the fire and my tent to make it look that big. Then I heard that owl sound again, the weird one. Sounded like it was real close to the back of my tent. And the shadow, walking around out front, stopped as soon as it heard that owl. Now I had both eyes open, bleary though they might be. I nudged Mike, and then I nudged him again, but he was completely out. Something about this situation set my teeth on edge, even half-loaded. I knew approximately where Jim, Bob, and Pete had their bags in relation to my tent, which is to say, not very far away, just a couple of feet. The person or the thing outside had stopped, and I had every reason to believe that it was standing, facing my three friends out there under the stars. And the profile I saw, it was nothing like any of the guys out there. Although we were in a very remote and rural area, it was not unheard of for people to trespass on land. Usually, it wasn't anything really to worry about. But right then, I was worried because something wasn't right. I was also worried because I knew there was a loaded rifle out there, somewhere. We mostly brought it with us in case a black bear wandered in too close. We brought it because we were made to by Mike's parents, and we had brought it out many, many times, and we had never once had to use it. When I thought about that rifle just lying around out there, and I knew that it was. Yes, we were stupid to do that, but that's why my dad called it being young man stupid. We did all know better, but we did stupid things anyway, like leave a loaded rifle out there. I assumed it was out there anyway. It was Mike's rifle, and I don't think he brought it in the tent with him. I hoped he had. I felt around, and I didn't feel it. I shook Mike very forcefully, but that only succeeded in making him mumble and turn over. And the person, or the thing outside the tent, heard that. The shadow now was broadside. It had turned our way towards the tent. I held my breath. I felt around Mike again, hoping against hope that I would find that he had brought the rifle in with him after all, but no such luck. I looked back, and I now saw the figure had turned back towards my friend, and he bent forward, and then I saw the longest, creepiest arms reach out, and they grabbed something with the hands. Yes, it absolutely had hands, and it pulled whatever it was upward at a slant. Then I knew what it was. It was one of the sleeping bags with one of my friends in it. I could hear the raspy, sliding noise of the rayon sleeping bag as it slid on the ground. I've heard people say they've been paralyzed with fear and that they couldn't move. I only had that happen to me one time. I was a kid, and I was in my bedroom late at night, and suddenly there was a monster's face in my bedroom window. I was so scared, I stood there with my mouth open trying to scream, but I couldn't. I made breathy-sounding squeaks. I couldn't run either. Finally, I heard my older brother's voice. He said, "What's wrong, dummy? Are you too scared to move or what?" Then he started laughing. It was him with a mask outside my window. I had never been frozen like that until then, and I was pretty sure what I was looking at. That was not my older brother out there in some costume coming to scare me. Then I heard a noise. It was the clear sound of someone struggling and saying something while half asleep. There might have even been a hint of laughter as if they were saying, "Yeah, yeah, good one, guys," or something like that. Then a split second later, there was all out terrified screaming. For some strange reason, I now had the ability to use my voice, and I could scream, and I could move. So I got out of that tent to, I don't know what I planned to do exactly. I had no weapon, and I wasn't a fighter, but I had to do whatever I could to help my friend out there. I am and was ashamed that I couldn't move to help him before that. And when I crawled out of that tent, and I got a good look at what was really going on out there, I stopped frozen again. Now I saw that all three of my friends were scrambling out of their sleeping bags. It was all a big, tangled, flurry mess. I saw sleeping bags and pillows and shoes flying, arms flailing, butt cracks showing, and whole bodies tumbling over one another. I do think my friend Pete came within a hair of pitching straight face forward right into the fire as he tried to stand up and fell forward in his sleeping bag. The shadowy shape that I had seen by firelight was illuminated clearly with the full moon. The light made a silver color on the hair that glinted, and the hair covered it everywhere that I could see, top to bottom. And wherever the moonlight wasn't shining on it, the eerie firelight lit this thing up. The only thing I never could clearly see was its eyes. I think about that a lot all these years later. I wish I could have seen its eyes. When I got out of that tent, that thing was holding the two corners of a sleeping bag. Later I would find out that it was my friend Bob in that bag. By that point, it had dropped the corners of the sleeping bag. It looked at us and straightened up to about 7.5 feet tall. Then it turned and started walking away, like nothing had happened there at all, like it wasn't a part of any of this ruckus. But as they say in the commercials, wait, there's more. We are focused and watching that thing walk off into the darkness of the trees, when suddenly another one, a much bigger one, makes a big point of walking right in front of us where we can see it. It gives us a look. Then it follows the other one. It didn't have to do that. From where it had been, it could have walked simply in a straight line and followed it, and not walked in front of us. But there was something about its posture, and the way it stopped and looked at us. It seemed threatening. The first one, however, really didn't seem that threatening. And yes, we saw it all by the light of the full moon. It was chaos. And you know what? My friend Mike was still in the tent. He still was not awake. He was truly passed out. We dragged Mike out of the tent and half carried him to the car. We left everything there and hoofed it out to the parking area. The three of them, Jim, Bob, and Pete, were in one car, and me and Mike, we were in my car. But we got to the cars, and guess who could not find their keys? That's right, me. So we all piled into Pete's car and wasted no time getting out of there. We went back there the next day. We told Mike's parents everything that had happened, and his father was 10 kinds of pissed at us for not only leaving a fire going, but for leaving all of our stuff, including the rifle. And, he said, for making up some big BS story to cover for it. But he felt differently when he got out there and he saw the tracks. They were huge. At first, he accused us of making them or faking them somehow. But soon enough, he started tracking them. And after he'd gone more than half a mile, and they were still going, Mike's dad circled back, and he didn't say much to us, but he had a very different attitude. We quickly got everything together and loaded in the cars. We did find the rifle, and I found my keys. They were under the edge of my sleeping bag, still in the tent. We got everything packed, and we got out of there. We did not return there again, although Mike said that other people in his family had spent time out there since. Mike's parents did eventually retire, and they did build a house there on that land. Zero problems for any of them since. That's right, it never came back. So, was it there because of the full moon? Could that draw them out? Were they just passing through on their way to somewhere else? What would they have done to Bob if they had been able to silently drag him off? There are more questions than answers for us about that Halloween night, and we certainly had more tricks than treats that Halloween night so long ago in 2001. My story is simple and straightforward, and although it's not exactly Halloween-related, I still think of it as incredibly scary. So please, if you will, include this in your Halloween thing. This was in Idaho, along the Henry's Fork River. I had been at the Mesa Falls. Actually, there are two sets of falls, one upper and one lower. Between the two falls is a very pleasant hiking trail that's about a mile long. I had already been to the upper falls, then I followed the trail down to the lower falls. From the lower falls, I made the trek up to the observation point. Then, being me, I went beyond the observation point, which is pretty rocky, and the area there is dotted with aspens and pines or firs of some kind. The rock there is very loose in spots. I was warned not to go up because the rocks shift very quickly. But again, me being me, I thought, oh well, I'll do it anyway. Now I have an incredible view of the falls and of the observation point. I can see all the way down to the falls where the bend curve of the falls comes in. The opposite bank is open and clear. There are some people on the other side of the falls bank. They're looking at the falls, and they're not paying attention to anything else. They had a young child with them. The child kept pulling away from the man trying to hold its hand. I'll assume this was the child's father, and it was the father and the mother that he's standing with there at the falls. The mom, I think, is taking pictures with her phone, and the man is holding the child's hand, looking at her phone as well. They were looking at the falls and the phone. The child was looking into the trees on the rock crop of the bank, maybe 30 feet away. The kid might have been 3 or 4 years old. The dad had been carrying him until they got to the bank and started taking pictures. Then he set him down and held his hand. So what was the kid so interested in over there, I thought. Now there are postings everywhere in that area about bears. So I thought maybe there was a bear over there, which really scared me for these people. They seemed to be unaware of anything but looking at the falls. So I get my binocs out from my pack, and I start glassing down the area. I kept looking, but all I saw were trees, trees, trees. But you know that kid? And I don't even know if it was a boy or a girl, because I only saw it from the back, and nothing about the clothing or anything else told me boy or girl, but the kid. That kid was doing its darndest to get away and go over to those trees. There was something over there. The kid kept tugging hard on the dad's arm. He kept trying to tell his dad something, and he kept pointing over to the trees. But the dad didn't seem to be paying him any attention. He was leaning and looking over, from what I could see, at the pictures on the phone that the mom had just taken. She was holding the phone between them so they both could look. So I glass back over, and I start looking to where the kid is looking at and pointing. I'm still not seeing anything, and... oh, wait, wait, what is that? Now I see it. There's a dark splotch of something... It was edging closer to the edge of the trees. No way, I thought. That's a bear. Those people are about to get attacked by a bear, and they don't even know it's there. I start yelling and waving my arms, but it's no good. They can't hear me all the way down there with all the sound of the waterfalls and the rushing water. I did not want to watch them be eaten by a bear, but I couldn't not look either. I had to know if they were going to be attacked, and if so, what happened so I could tell authorities. I looked back through my binoculars again. While they may not have heard me, the bear did hear me. I saw that the bear was now standing on its back legs, looking up in my direction. I realized the bear had no snout, and the snout that wasn't there was all dark. It wasn't lighter like the bears in the area should be. I also didn't see rounded ears on the top sides of its head. I should see that if it's a bear. And the leg or paw or arm, whatever it was, it was curled around the trunk of the tree, and it had a suspicious formation that looked very much like human fingers, and I couldn't see any claws. I turned up the power on my binoculars and zoomed in as much as I could on the face. There was no doubt. It was looking right at me. I could see the brownish, amber-colored eyes very well. I backed down the power on the binoculars, and I took in the whole shape of the being, and I came to understand what it was I was looking at. I saw its eyes look away from me, and back to, I assume, the child. Then they looked back at me. I knew right then it wanted that child. It was luring that child away. I tried again frantically to yell and wave my arms. I even jumped up and down, which almost caused me to slide on the loose rocks. Again, it was all for nothing. They couldn't hear me. The couple and the child stayed there maybe another 3 or 4 minutes. I watched the whole time breathlessly through my binoculars. When they finally left the bank of the falls, I watched the face of the creature as they left. It looked angry. Then I saw it shift its eyes up to look at me again. I lowered the binoculars immediately. I started to get down from there. I didn't like what I saw in its eyes. And there might have been a river and a waterfall between us, but I wasn't feeling too sure at that moment that that thing couldn't find a way to get over to me and somehow make me pay for what it thinks I did to make it lose that child. I really had the feeling it blamed me for not being able to get that child. To this day, I am both chilled and haunted by how unaware the parents were to the danger lurking nearby, ogling their child. I've often wondered, did they make it out safe? Did it follow them on the trail? I have no way of knowing. You know how they say karma's one of those real nasty women and she'll come back and get you when you least expect it. Well, there's truth in that. So here's my story. Now, I'm not proud of this, but when I was younger, I was one of those rural boys who thought the best thing to do with any free time I had was to go out and rip up a bunch of stuff. I'd get together with friends and we would just terrorize the whole county. We would set garbage cans on fire, shoot BB guns at someone who had the gall to get some new vinyl siding. Well, we didn't shoot at the people, but at their pretty new siding. Now, that might not make any sense, I know, but there was just something about people getting all uppity and getting nice and new stuff. It used to piss us off royally like you wouldn't believe. Now I recognize it as jealousy, because we were so poor, we didn't have anything. We just couldn't allow that uppityness of people having nicer things than us go unchecked. Well, those were only some of the things that we used to do as teens. One of the other things that we thought of almost as a sport was mailbox bashing. Now, we knew there were some spoil sports out there, as we thought of them. They would go and fill up their mailbox posts with concrete or house their mailboxes in thick brick and things like that. So we would always go scope them out the day before. Now, this was real easy for us to do in particular because one of my friend's mothers used to deliver the local newspaper, and a lot of the mailboxes on her rural route had an extra area under for the newspaper. Now, when he would go out with her, he always made notes of which ones were spoil sports, so we always had good targets. Now, this one night, it was autumn. I can't say it was Halloween, though, but the leaves on the road were everywhere. You could smell the wet leaves even as we drove along. You know that weird smell they have when they get wet and starting to decay? Well, anyway, me and my two friends, Drew and Scott, we got together and we went out this one night. This would have been 1982. Now, Scott had a great trouble car, as we called it. It was one of those big behemoths from the 70s. It was a 1976 Pontiac Grand Prix. Long, sleek, had two doors, and it was black as night. You could turn the lights off on that car, and it was like a big black ghost just gliding along those rural roads. No one ever saw it. You know, I think back, and I think it's a miracle we didn't drive right off the road or seriously hit something while driving with the lights out, which we frequently did for kicks. Anyway, it was the perfect car to take and go out and get in some trouble. Hence our name, Trouble Car. So this one night, we all had our bats and we were all wound up to just go tear some stuff up. We had a couple of houses that had had the gall to replace the very mailboxes we took the time to go bash down a few weeks before. So you know they were first on our list. Again, we can't be having people having nicer things than us. Nope, nope, nope. So we headed out on a particular rural road where half the fun for us was that at any time there could be one of those men living in those houses just waiting off the side of the road for us, maybe with a shotgun. Now that was just the salt and pepper on the mashed potatoes for us. Yes, sir, we were dumb teens. But I think we've already established that. Now, we had already smashed quite a few mailboxes, and we were getting bored. You know, the same old, same old, same old. You understand, right? But as we were talking, we talked about there was this one old lady who had these great big square and rectangular cement planters sitting on her porch, and she always had a billion flowers in them. Oh, heck no. We can't be having that, can we, boys? We cannot have someone being uppity with nice things. So we had to go do something about it, we decided. Now, she lived right on the edge of town. It wasn't really rural, but she didn't have any close neighbors that could spot us either. So we figured she'd be easy pickings. So we stopped down the road from her house, shut off the car and the lights, and then we three silently pushed the car to just past her driveway. That way, we could do the deed, and the one in the car could fire it up and we could be running off and taking before anyone knew anything. And we wouldn't be giving ourselves away by the sound of a running motor sitting out on the road. Now, we had a thing of drawing lots back then with cigarettes. We all smoked, of course, and what we would do is we would take a pack of cigarettes, we would burn the end of one cigarette, immediately put it out, so it left it with a black tip, but it wasn't any shorter than any of the other cigarettes. Now, we would put that blackened-tipped cigarette and most of the other cigarettes back in the soft pack, leaving a couple of them out so there was room in that soft pack to kind of roll the cigarettes around and mix them up. Then, one by one, we would take turns, and we would shake a cigarette out of the little torn end of the soft pack, just like you were getting a cigarette out to smoke. We would look at it. And we kept taking turns until one of us drew the burnt cigarette. Then that person had to go do whatever the dare or the dangerous thing was. Now that night, to go destroy those cement planters and run up to her house, I had drawn the burned cigarette. So it was up to me. We got the car in position, and I went up and I was ready to start busting up planters. Only then, as I got onto her porch, ready to swing, did I realize what a dumb idea this was. I do not go swinging at cement-lined mailboxes for all the obvious reasons. So why did I think swinging at some stationary cement planters was somehow a good idea? I thought about it for a second. Then I decided, nah, I'm just going to rip out all the flowers and make her porch look no better than my own, which currently looked like someone had tipped a dumpster on our lawn and my old man had pulled some crap out of the pile and decided to decorate our porch with it. It was a matter of honor, almost. I cannot have someone shoving their nice things in my face, reminding me that I didn't have nice things. I keep saying that over and over now because, as an adult, I'm amazed at my thoughts back then and how I reasoned things out. I'm ashamed as well, but that was exactly what I was thinking about as I stood there on her dark porch, feeling my way around
and trying to decide what to do. Then I heard Drew, who came halfway down the driveway. He asked me in a low hiss, "What are you doing? What's taking so long?" Those two had been gleefully waiting and anticipating the sound of the crash of the baseball bat on all the cement planters, and they were displeased that they weren't hearing it. "Change of plans," I hissed back at him. I knew they wanted some sound of destruction to hear, and that was fair, I thought, and I would give them that, but not the planters smashing. Instead, I quickly tore through every planter I could find in the darkness, and I ripped out every flower I could find, tossed them everywhere. With that done, I turned to the full glass screen door. I thought, yeah, that might make a nice sound with all that glass crashing and shattering. I could do that, and we'd all be off before the old woman got up the nerve to hobble her old butt down the stairs with that ancient .38 that we had seen her waving around the year before. Never you mind why she was waving an old .38 at us, but she did. Anyway, I found the glass door. I lined up with it, took a step back, and I hoisted my baseball bat up. I know, I was standing there grinning evilly in the dark, just relishing the feel of about to wreak havoc. Batter up, I thought, and I pulled very far back to swing. But I never got the chance, as they say. Out on the road where my friend was with the car, I heard a distinct yell. Then I heard the car fire up and the Grand Prix squealed tires as my friend put the hammer down, and he left me and Drew there in the dark. I quickly ran off the porch, meeting Drew out on the gravel driveway. We were both stunned, wondering, what the heck just happened? We ran down the gravel driveway to the road, and we watched as his taillights grew smaller in the distance. He had left us. But then suddenly, we saw the taillights disappear, only to reappear half a second later. A chill crept around my belly and coiled up very tight like an icy snake. I knew someone or something had crossed the road, momentarily blocking our view of those fading taillights. It was nothing, probably nothing, I thought, probably just a deer. But there we were, standing in the middle of a road in total darkness. Now, if you've only ever lived in the city or a suburb, you might not know what real darkness is. There are no street lights out there, no porch lights, no ambient lights of any kind, nothing. "What the heck?" my friend Drew said. I said, "I don't know, but when I get a hold of him, I'm gonna..." And that's as far as I got. Something was walking right off the side of the road, right in the ditch line, and it was coming right towards us, and it wasn't even bothering to be quiet. I felt Drew's hand smack my chest, then latch onto my arm. He pulled me, and we started running. Now, in hindsight, that was probably the stupidest mistake I could make. It was dark. We couldn't see what we were running from or running to. If it was a predator, running is never a good idea, but at the same time, staying put and waiting for it isn't a good idea either. We ran blindly down what we thought was the road. More than once, we went off the road, our ankles rolling and at one point taking us both down. But we got right back up because we could both hear the heavy pounding thuds of something large behind us. The terror was real, my friends. 40 years later, and I still feel that icy snake in my belly when I think about that night. That feeling of just waiting for something to reach out and grab you in the darkness. That's a feeling of pure terror that cannot be conveyed with mere words. Now, in the distance, we saw headlights coming our way. They were coming at us very fast. Then there was the honking of a horn frantically. We started waving our arms and yelling loudly for them to please stop. The car came close, slammed on the brakes, fishtailed slightly, and we dove over to the side of the road. It narrowly missed us. And just as we got out of the way, we heard the sound of an impact, followed by a painful screaming yell that split the night. Whoever was in that car was now blowing their horn, and I could hear Scott yelling for us, "Come on, guys, come on!" It was Scott. Shaking like leaves in the wind, we both got up and ran and dove into the car. But we saw in the headlights the thing that had been following us. A shaggy heap of brown fur lay in the road. As I was getting in the car, I stopped and looked for just a second. Then Drew and Scott grabbed my shoulder and pulled me into the car. I shut the door, and we were off. I saw arms and legs. It was just lying in the road like a human would. As we backed up to turn the big car around, I also saw the shaggy heap was trying to lift itself off the pavement. Scott squealed those tires a second time, and we tore down that country road. We stopped at Drew's house, which was the closest to where we had been. We parked, and we went down to the basement, which was our normal hangout. Drew's parents were never home. His dad was an over-the-road trucker, and his mom worked the night shift at a truck stop out by the interstate. So, with rarely adults there, you know it was our favorite place. We spent the night down there in a very agitated state. We were all talking over each other all at once. Then we would go quiet. We would ask each other a million questions over and over, the same ones. Then we'd get up and pace around the basement. What was it? That's what we kept asking each other. What was it? And then it was, "How could you leave us, man?" We kept asking Scott that question. In Scott's defense, he said he panicked. He was sitting there with the windows down in the car so he could hear what was going on as I went up to the old lady's porch. He had turned his head toward the old lady's property, waiting for sound or the signal, so he was ready to turn the key in the ignition. His fingers, he said, were waiting on the key in the ignition. That's when out of the darkness, a paw or a hand reached into the car and almost pulled him right out of the window. That's when he panicked and he sped out of there. Now, to Scott's credit, he did come back for us. It was almost morning before he told us that when he came down the road, he started honking his horn because he saw what was behind us. He said it was weaving back and forth behind us, taking great steps, like it couldn't decide which one of us to grab. It was at least a foot and a half taller than either of us, he said. And he said that the eyes in the headlights reflected with orange eyeshine. And when he fishtailed around us, he said he hit it hard on the side, not head on. Sure enough, there was a dent in the back quarter panel of the Grand Prix. It was very visible when we looked at it the next day. Now, that probably doesn't sound like a big deal today to have a dent in the car, but back then, those cars from the 70s, man, they were made out of solid steel. To put a dent in one of those, that wasn't easily done. So, there it is. That's the night that my friend tried to run a Bigfoot down to save us. And we never went out to just destroy things again, either. Maybe we grew up that night. I don't want to say we were scared, but I think we grew up. We realized there were scarier things out there in that county than just us. Matter of fact, I have to say, this is where karma is not a lady I like. I've been waiting to catch me that young punk who thinks it's real funny to steal all my tomatoes from my garden lately, and then he throws them at my house. He's been doing that all summer. My wife, she adores those little garden gnomes, and there's been someone, probably the same little punk, stealing all my tomatoes. They've been smashing them. Sometimes they just disappear. Now, I think I know who it is, And I've seen where he lives and what he's got, and I know his parents. I reckon I know why he's doing it. But I think he needs to be taught a lesson. Too bad I don't have a Bigfoot friend to help me out. Serve up that lesson. Signed, Trevor from Missouri.